Good morning, everyone. Sweet Money here, and welcome back to another episode of Hack My Laborer, the Starbase Tutorial Series where we rip apart your poor laborer module and try to put it back together again, only slightly better. Today is going to be a YOLOL day. We're going to install some YOLOL racks in our ships so we can write and store many more chips without needing a socket for everyone. We're also going to rework some of our existing code and create some new YOLOL that makes use of memory chips. As always, if you're enjoying this series, please don't forget to leave a like and subscribe so you don't miss the next one. Leave me a comment about some cool upgrades you haven't seen yet that you'd be interested in seeing an episode about. I also stream every Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday on Twitch if you want to watch me figure out how to do this stuff live. That's enough intro, let's get to work. First things first, we're running out of space for all of our YOLOL scripts. We could keep adding additional sockets to the ship, but they take up a lot of wall space and some chips we just don't need access to so readily. Starbase gives us a nice solution to this problem with YOLOL racks. These racks are empty shells that can be expanded to hold 1, 2, or 3 YOLOL chips at a time. They also stack so you don't need to run power to each one individually. The research for YOLOL rack chip readers is pretty easy, so feel free to grab it if you're interested in crafting. Otherwise, you can find them on the auction house. The other bit of new technology we're going to start playing with today is YOLOL memory chips. This research is a little bit further down, and crafting it requires exorium, so you might be better off just grabbing one off the auction house for next to nothing. We're going to start with 4 YOLOL rack 48x48x48cm units, 2 YOLOL rack chip slot 2 slots, and 2 YOLOL rack chip slot 3 slots. Also, go ahead and buy that YOLOL memory chip from the auction house if you haven't already. Head to the front of our ship where we put our battery expansion. We're going to hang our new YOLOL racks on this post right here since they fit perfectly. Start with the empty rack units and place 2 of them on each side with the thick blue rectangle on the top. Auto-bolt these down and place the 2 2-slot rack inserts into the top racks until they snap in place. The 2-slot rack insert is the only one that contains a power and data port, so you'll need at least one of these for each stack of racks that you have. Go ahead and auto-bolt these in place to insert the single bolt that secures them. We might as well install the 3-slot inserts as well. Place both of these in the empty racks and auto-bolt them in place. Now we'll just need to connect these stacks to power so they're ready to accept chips. Use the cable tool to run a wire from the circle port on front of our rack along the wall towards the transponder. I'm okay with clipping the wire through the back of the rack, but you can go around if you like. And that's all there is to that. Now we have a nice area where we can run 10 YOLOL chips without taking up an entire wall with sockets, with plenty of room to add more racks down to the floor. We'll leave these sockets in the back so we can use them for code we're actively working on, but we can move some of our more finalized chips into the racks now. Our ISAN chip is pretty final, so we can start with that one. Grab the chip with E and just carry it up front to our new rack. Rotate it so it lines up with one of the slots on the rack and let it snap into place. Release the chip with E like normal and it should be running again. As long as the chip snapped into the slot, you should be able to trust that the code is running. You can also remove a chip from the rack by grabbing it with E again. I'm going to move our ISAN reboot script and our material point scanner script into the racks as well since we're basically done with those two. Now let's place our new memory chip in one of the rack slots. If you pull out your universal tool in data mode while hovering over the memory chip, you'll see 10 field names. Each memory chip has 10 field names that can be renamed to anything you'd like and will save any value you set to that variable name. We're going to rename this first field to BatPCT. Before running back to write some YOLOL, let's rename some things on one of our batteries here. Hover over any of the batteries and press U to pull out our universal tool in data mode. We'll rename stored battery power to bat stored and max battery power to bat max, just to make them a little shorter. Now we can write some YOLOL. We're going to write 3 small one-line YOLOL scripts. We'll be replacing our current turtle mode script, so you just need 2 more chips for now. Place them in some of the sockets we just emptied and we'll write our first simple script. The first script is going to calculate the percent of battery left over, so we don't have to calculate it in every script we write. We use colon BatPCT because that's what we call the first field on our memory chip. This means when we set BatPCT in this YOLOL chip, the value will be saved to the memory chip and available for other chips and devices to use. Then we set colon battery to equal the battery percent and we just repeat this forever. Now we can go to our dashboard and rename our battery 1 screen to display our battery percent instead. Rename battery 1 to battery and then erase the field name max battery power. Erasing any field name will just reset it to its default name. Set that field's value to 100. I also changed panel variable resolution to 0.1 so we get a decimal point on the screen. We'll figure out something to do with the other battery screen later. Our next script is going to control our generator a bit more dynamically. Currently, we just set the generator to either 80 or 55 depending on the turtle mode. We're going to write something a little nicer that will kick the generator on and off based on our battery needs. I know this looks complicated, but I'm going to try to break it down for you. We start by setting the local variable gen. We then take the generator button and multiply it by 100. This will mean the first statement here will either be 0 or 100, depending on if the generator button is on or off. Now we encase almost everything after this in parentheses, so we're multiplying it all by either 0 or 100. The first thing we check is if bat percentage is less than 80. This means everything in this parentheses will either be 0 if our batteries are at least 80%, or 1 if our batteries have fallen below 80%. Next, we check if GM is currently greater than 20. This means this statement will either be 1 if the generator is getting more than 20% fuel already, or 0 if it's not. We check if battery percentage is equal to 100% or not. If it does not equal 100%, which is what exclamation equals means in most programming languages, then this parentheses will be a 1. If it has hit 100%, it will be a 0. On the next line, we add 20 if the generator button is on, so we're always running at least 20%, just to give us a little head start. We set all of this to colon GM, which is what we renamed fuel chamber unit rate limit to way back when. So if we narrow everything down to ones and zeros, it's a little easier to understand what's happening here. GM will get set to either 20 if the battery has hit 100%, or 220 if the battery has fallen below 80%, or 120 if the battery is above 80% but not yet 100%. This means that the generator will warm up whenever our batteries fall below 80% and stay on full until they get charged back up to 100%. I know a line of code like this can be hard to read, but even when writing it, I often go over what each set of parentheses is doing in my head to make sense of what's going on. Last job we're going to do is to adjust our turtle mode script. We can erase everything from our current turtle script and just use this one line. We're adding an additional safety measure here that probably won't get used a lot in the future, but will be nice to have right now. We'll adjust the FCU general multiplier to slowly decrease if the battery is below 25%. FCU general multiplier is basically a global choke on the entire flight computer. This line will be set to 4 times the current battery percentage, so it won't actually be under 100% until the batteries are below 25%. Then when we set TM, which we named our throttle lever's lever max output field, we set it to 100 minus 85 times turtle. Colon turtle will be 0 or 1 depending on if the turtle button is off or on. So if it's off, we won't subtract anything from 100. But if it's on, we subtract 85, which will give us 15% max throttle. We can take our ship for a quick test drive and see when our battery falls below 80%, the fuel chamber unit rate starts to climb. The generator will continue to ramp up and eventually start charging the battery again. Once the battery gets to 100%, the generator will drop back down to 20%. This script will be incredibly easy to adjust once we add more generators and batteries to our ship in future episodes and will become a lot better. Just know that this is not its final form. For the time being, the turtle mode script should help choke our thrusters in emergencies, so we should never deplete our batteries completely. So there you go. Hopefully your brains are sufficiently wrinkled and you've learned some new things about YOLOL. Thank you for watching. If you've been enjoying this series, please remember to leave a like to help me out with that pesky algorithm. Feel free to subscribe so you don't miss the next episode. Another friendly reminder, I stream every Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday on Twitch if you want to watch me fumble around trying to figure these things out live. Thanks again for watching. I will see you in the next one, but for now, please take it easy.